Well, good morning. Great to see you all, and a very big and happy new year to you all. And those with us on the streaming, happy new year. Thank you for joining us. And you survived Christmas, survived New Year. Did you peg out a spot down near the fireworks? And no, you'd have to be there early, wouldn't you? Anyway, good to see you all again today. And it's good to have Rhonda and Ron back with us, our wandering gypsies. So nice to see you with us today. So there's quite a few people away, so just keep people that are travelling in our prayers. So Daphne will be back on the 8th, and May's going to be away for quite a while. She's gone up to the Blue Mountains for a few weeks, and then she's departing on the 21st of January to Singapore, and she said she'll be away for about 3 months. So that's quite a big trick, big time away. So particularly keep her in your thoughts and prayers, and also for others that are taking time away, that they'll get back safely and join us in due time and have a refreshing break. Our services in the hostels are just having a break. That helps our volunteers to have a bit of a break as well. So they won't be on next week, but they'll be beginning again the week after on the, I think it's the 13th. So I think that's about it for the announcements, but I don't know if you like always eat too much at Christmas. I get too many chocolates. Go easy on the chocolates. If you All right, please join me now in a call to worship. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give humble and hearty thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all people. We bless you for our creation, our preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for your amazing love in the redemption offered to the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and the hope of glory. And we pray, give us that due sense of all your mercies, that our hearts may be truly thankful, and that we may declare your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service, and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom, with you and the Holy Spirit, be all honour, glory, now and forever. Amen. Our first hymn will be How Great Thou Art.
I see the stars.
I'm reading from Hebrews 4:4-16 about Jesus as our great high priest. Therefore, since we have a great high priest who has ascended into heaven, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are. Yet he did not sin. Let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. My dear friends, the scriptures urge us to acknowledge our many sins and not to conceal them in the presence of God, our Heavenly Father, but to confess them with penitent and obedient hearts, so that we may be forgiven through his boundless goodness and mercies. We ought always humbly to admit our sins before God, but chiefly when we meet together to give thanks for the benefits we have received at his hands, to offer the praise that's due him, to hear his holy word, and to ask is what is necessary for the body as well as the soul. Therefore, let us draw near to the throne of our gracious God. So please take a little bit of time for personal reflection, and then I'll share a confession, and you might like to join in with me in that. Share the confession. Almighty and most merciful Father, we have strayed from your ways like lost sheep. We have left undone what we ought to have done, and we have done what we ought not to have done. We have followed our own ways and the desires of our own hearts. We have broken your holy laws. Yet, good Lord, have mercy on us. Restore those who are penitent, according to your promises declared to mankind in Jesus Christ our Lord. And grant, merciful Father, for his sake, that we may live a godly and obedient life to the glory of your holy name. Amen. The God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ pardons and absolves all who truly repent and believe his holy gospel. For God desires not the death of a sinner, but rather that they should turn from their sin and live. Therefore, when we turn to God in sincere repentance to receive the forgiveness of our sins and ask him to grant us true repentance by his Holy Spirit, that we may please him, that our lives may be pure and holy, so that at the last we may come to eternal joy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. There's some prayers and responses, so they'll be up for you to join in. Open our lips, O Lord. O God, make speed to save us. Glory to God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
As in the beginning, so now, and forever.
Let us praise the Lord.
Lord's name be praised.
And we'll do that with our next hymn, And Can It Be?
Thank you.
I'll just say a prayer for the hearing of God's word. Lord, I pray that you open our hearts and minds to your word today, that you'll teach us things, that you'll reveal us things. And Lord, I pray that you quicken us to want to follow your spirit and be obedient to your word. In Jesus' name, amen. So I'd like to invite Arthur to bring our Old Testament reading and Beb to bring our New Testament reading. Thank you.
Psalm 8. Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory in the heavens. Through the praise of children and infants, you have established a stronghold against your enemies to silence the foe and the avenger. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars, which you have set in place, what is mankind that you are mindful of them, human beings that you care for them? You have made them a little lower than the angels and crowned them with glory and honour. You made them rulers over the works of your hands. You put everything under their feet, all flocks and herds and the animals of the wild, the birds in the sky and the fish in the sea, all that swim the paths of the seas. Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth.
The New Testament reading is from Philippians 2, starting at verse 5. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks, Arthur, and thanks, Beb, for bringing our readings to us. So I'm encouraged because I think this is a great place to start our new year with. And my theme today is Jesus, our example of humility for us to follow. The reformer Martin Luther reported there was once two mountain goats who met each other on a narrow ledge, just wide enough for one animal to pass. On the left was a sheer cliff, and on the right was a sheer wall. The two were facing each other, and it was impossible to turn back. How did they solve their dilemma? And Martin Luther went on. If they'd been people, they would have butted each other until they plunged into the chasm together. But Luther said the goats had more sense than that. One lay down on the trail and let the other walk over him, and both were safe. Now, there was a division at the church of Philippi, so Paul urges them to pocket their pride and to live and work as one. Anything less is unworthy of the one whose life on earth is the extreme example of humility, or superior example of humility. Now let's look at the few verses that just went before the passage that we heard read from Philippians. So I'm going to read from Philippians 2, 1 to 14. About imitating Christ's humility. Paul writes, "Therefore, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, If any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and one in mind. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of others. So Paul makes an appeal for unity through humility. Humility is not a natural instinct for us human beings. Humility is primarily a personal quality of dependence on God and respect of other people. Humility was abhorred in the ancient world, particularly by the Greeks and the Romans. We also live in a society that is obsessed with individualism to the expense of community. We see this in marketing appeals, particularly the iPhone, the iPad. I is the most important individual. So this advertising taps into the individual ego. We as Christians need to abide in Christ in humility. If we live this way in fellowship with the Holy Spirit, then the fellowship produces tenderness and compassion for each other. Humility is the source of our unity. But self-centered pride and selfish ambition work against and are the moral enemies of church fellowship. The humble person depends on God and serves sacrificially without favoritism by showing equal concern for all. This unity then springs from love and recognition of others and their unique gifts in the body of Christ. So let me encourage you, don't allow worldly competitiveness or one-upmanship to divide us. We need each other. Margaret Thatcher said once, "I am extraordinarily patient, provided I get my way in the end." Now, Gina and I sat under a church leader for many years, and she'll know who I'm talking about. And he'd often insist on his way, but he had a sneaky way of getting his way. If you didn't agree, or you didn't feel God was saying that or leading us as a fellowship that way, he'd say, "All right, well, let's meet and pray together," which sounded very sensible and the right thing. But he would meet and pray together with us until we all came around to his way of thinking. So it was a subtle way to get his way. But that's not the way of Christ. It's not the way of Christ to bully one another. Ezekiel 34:20-21 says this, "Therefore says the Lord God to them, I myself shall judge between the fat sheep and the lean sheep, because you pushed with flank and shoulder and butted all the weak animals with your horns until you scattered them far and wide." So that's the way not to be. Now let's look at Christ's way for us. Philippians 2:5. "In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Jesus Christ." We're encouraged to have the same self-sacrificing humility and love for others as Christ. Philippians 2:5-6. Talking about Jesus, "who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness." Now, Christ, the Son of God, existed eternally as God and is fully God and equally God with the Father and the Holy Spirit. One God, but a Trinity of persons, Father, Son, and Spirit. Now, although Christ was equally God with divine privileges and status, he didn't hold on to them like a prize to be grasped. Jesus was humble, giving up his rights in order to obey his Father and serve us as a slave. Yes, as a slave. By taking the very nature of the servant, that word servant actually means slave. So the incarnation of Christ is coming from heaven to earth. Christ was willing to obey his Father, to give up his position. He made himself nothing. He emptied himself. It wasn't self-renunciation. He did not cease to be God and exchange himself to become human. Rather, it was renouncing the privileges of his deity. It's a bit like a king becoming a slave. Yet in this case, it was more. The God of the universe becoming a man to serve us. In submission to his Father, Christ's deity was limited by putting on humanity. He was limited to our space and time. His knowledge and power was limited while human. Christ took on the essential attributes of humanity and became one of us. He identified with our basic human needs and weakness. He became the God-man, fully God, fully human, and while on earth, Christ was materially poor. Philippians 2:8. And being found in the appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on the cross. In appearance of a man, this is merely a repetition of the last verse, but a shift from the heavenly focus to the earthly focus. Jesus Christ's humanity is described from the point of view of those who saw him. Paul is saying, though outwardly he looked like a man, there was more to him than people recognised. In other words, his deity was hidden. It was shrouded. You see a little bit of it come forth on the Mount of Transfiguration. So this hidden deity is seen in Jesus' rejection, particularly from his own townfolk. Matthew 13:54-57. Coming to his hometown, he began teaching the people in their synagogue, and they were amazed. Where did this man get this wisdom and these miraculous powers, they asked. Isn't this the carpenter's son? Isn't his mother's name Mary? Aren't his brothers James, Joseph, and Simon and Judas with us? Aren't all his sisters here? Where then did this man get all these things? And they took offence at him. Now Jesus humbled himself further. He did not demand human rights, but subjected himself to persecution and suffering at the hands of non-believers. You'll be familiar with that verse from Isaiah 53:7. He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. Often with honour, great suffering accompanies it. Abraham Lincoln, and remember he had a very difficult presidency at a very difficult time during the Civil War. Abraham Lincoln was asked by a friend, "How does it feel to be the President of the United States?" Lincoln reportedly replied that it was like the man tarred and feathered and run out of town on a train. When someone in the crowd asked how he enjoyed it, he replied, "If it were not for the honour, I'd just walk." It was difficult for Christ to face his suffering. His prayer was, "Not my will, but yours be done." He was humble and obedient to the end to his Father, which led to his death on the cross. By following God's plan, Jesus went to the lowliest point of extremity in his humiliation, dying as a criminal by crucifixion, a most degrading death. The Jews hated this method of death and considered anyone hung on a tree cursed by God. And that's a passage in Deuteronomy 21:33. But Jesus took our punishment. He took our sin in his sacrificial death. He took our place. He took the curse of sin for us so that we'd be freed from sin's curse. And because of this, God exalted him. Philippians 2:9-11. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place, gave him the name above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. For this reason, God exalted him. And in addition to Christ receiving back his glory in heaven, Christ's new status as the God-man meant God gave him privileges that he did not have prior to his incarnation. If he had not lived among us, he could not have identified with us as our interceding high priest, as we heard from that passage in Hebrews. If he had not died on the cross, he could not have elevated from the lowliest degree back to heaven as the substitute for our sin. Now his name is above all names in heaven and on earth. Christ's new name as Lord means he is sovereign. He is ruler over all creation. When we heard that passage in Psalm 8 about humans put in over all creation, we look around and we make a bit of a muck of it, don't we? We tend to ruin it. But Jesus, as the God-man, is the rightful ruler. And this is the rightful title for Jesus. As the God-man, humanity has been added to deity. Everyone will bow before him. The entire intelligent universe is called to recognize his authority. Angels of heaven, obedient believers do it, willing and joyfully. But demons and rebels against God do it, but unwillingly and painfully. On that day, Jesus Christ will have universal recognition of his authority and his right to rule. The purpose of God's exaltation of Christ is to bring glory to the Father and redemption from the corruption of sin for all his creation, us and creation. We need to learn humility now by yielding to Christ's authority and living in him. John 5:5, Jesus said, "I'm the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing." Now, I just want to finish this with an illustration. Now, many of you have probably been up near the old Mona Vale Hospital. There's still an emergency section up there. There's a rehabilitation section up there as well. Well, just near the headlands around the corner, lots of hand gliders go off and you can watch them, and they just seem to float there in the air. It's a very popular place for hand gliders to be launched off. Well, let me tell you about a story of a guy that was riding his hand glider, and he launched off somewhere in America, and his name was Ronald Pickerton. and he describes a near accident he had while hang gliding. I said hang gliding, it's hang gliding. His hang was forcefully lifted 4,200 feet in the air. That's a very long way up. Then as he descended, he was hit by a down blast of air. He was falling at an alarming rate, trapped in an air riptide. These are his words. I was going to crash. Then I saw a hawk. He was 6 feet off to my right wingtip, fighting the same gust as I was. Now, when you see a hawk fighting the same gust, there's a lot to worry about. I looked down 300 feet and falling fast. The trees looked like spikes. I looked at the hawk again, and suddenly he banked and flew straight downwind. Downwind. If the right air is anywhere, it would be upwind. The hawk was committing suicide. 200 feet and the ground was racing up. Then from nowhere, the thought entered my mind, follow the hawk. It went against all my training about flying, but now my knowledge was useless. I was at the mercy of the wind. So I followed the hawk. 100 feet and suddenly the hawk gained altitude. For a split second, I seemed to be suspended, motionless in space. Then a surge of warm air pushed the glider up gently. I was stunned. Nothing I knew as a pilot explained this phenomenon, but it was true. I was rising. On occasions, we can have similar downdrafts in our own lives, reversal in our fortunes, humiliating experiences. We want to lift ourselves up, but God's word, like the hawk, tells us to do just the opposite. God's word tells us to dive, to humble ourselves under the hand of God. If we humble ourselves, God will send a thermal wind that will lift us up. James 4:10 says, humble yourselves under the hand of God and he will lift you up. Join me now as I pray. Lord, help us give up our selfish, demanding and self-willed ways. Let us learn from your example and help us to have genuine humility as we learn to depend on you more and more and to serve others with a loving and sacrificial heart. Amen. Our next song will be I Will Sing the Wondrous Story, and I really enjoy this song because it's about our personal journey with the Lord, and during this song your free will offering will be taken up. Thank you.
Thank you.
Lord, I thank you for the offering from people's hearts to help towards the Christian work here in the village. And Lord, help us to be reminded to honour you in our hearts, to serve you. It is a great honour, Lord. Sometimes we find the sacrifice hurts, but Lord, you sacrifice far more than what we will ever do, but help us also be living sacrifices. Amen. We haven't said the Apostles' Creed for a little while, and the Apostles' Creed is just a little concise summary of some of the most essential things that we believe as Christians. So let's say it together as a reminder of our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Christ Jesus, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead and buried. He descended to the dead. The third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. I'm going to invite John to come up and lead us in the prayers of the people. Thanks, John.
Well, good morning, everyone, and Happy New Year to you all. Let us pray. Almighty God, our Father in heaven, we come before you on this first day of the new year, 2023. And as we say goodbye to 2022 with its highlights and its lowlights, with its challenges and rewards, we look forward with optimism and hope to what the coming year might bring. And we have this hope because we know, loving God, that you are always with us. You will never forsake us. And so we pray for a strengthening of our faith. We pray for a renewed commitment to the teachings of Jesus Christ. One of the tragedies of 2022 was the shooting of those two police officers in Queensland. And we are reminded that when military personnel or police officers put on their uniforms, they are making a statement that says, in effect, I am prepared to put my life in harm's way so that you may live in peace and safety. So please watch over and protect them all, Father, as they confront those elements of our society that are increasingly dangerous. And the floods of recent months are still having a devastating effect on many communities around the country. We pray that things will improve in the near future and that the year 2023 will see a restoration to normality in the lives of those affected. We pray now for those of our congregation who are away on holidays, they're not with us today. We pray for their safe return. We pray for those in the village and especially those in the care homes who are facing health issues that leave them demoralised and depressed. Please strengthen and encourage them as they come to terms with their situation. And we pray for all the staff in the care homes who have had to deal with another difficult year of staff shortages and lockdowns. Please renew their strength and commitment to those in their care. We pray for our political leaders, both federal and state, that they would use godly wisdom and integrity in the decisions they make that affect us all. And we pray that you would continue to uphold and strengthen our two chaplains, Tony and Bob, as they serve the needs of our chapel community, as well as the village community. And we pray also, Father, for the people of Ukraine. We heard news overnight there's been more intensive shelling, and it's devastating the people in that country. So please, we ask you to strengthen their fortitude, strengthen their resilience until this barbaric invasion comes to an end. And finally, loving God, we thank you for the many blessings that you have bestowed on us during the past year. And we pray for your continued benevolence toward us and our families in 2023. And we pray all this in the name of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you, John, and for those wonderful prayers. And I was just thinking about the people in the care homes, and they're people we do need to uphold in prayer, but particularly the staff. When there's COVID outbreaks, they've got to wear all that PPE gear, and it's very difficult for them, and a lot of them are just getting worn out. They're just finding it too much because it's gone on for years. So keep them in prayers, and they're our real heroes. They have to face that often, regularly, and a lot of them are on pretty low pay just doing it because they really care for the residents. So we're very blessed to have people like that serving us in the hostels and nursing homes in particular. My sending forth prayer. Lord, our Heavenly Father, almighty and everlasting God, we thank you for bringing us safely to this day. Defend us with your mighty power. Grant that today we may not fall into sin or run into any kind of danger, but that we may be governed by you in all things and do what is right in your sight, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. Now, the last one's a pretty lively one. It's Lord of the Dance. So I don't know if you want to get up and dance for it or not.